I'm Jeff, and I reported Bill Ayres in 1987 on behalf of my 15-year-old client. And I was a mandated reporter, and the standard protocol in those days was if someone told you that they had been molested or abused, that you were to call the county within 24 hours. I called Child Protective Services within 24 hours, gave them a full report on what my client had told me, told them that Bill Ayres was the perpetrator. And in those days, it was standard procedure as the reporting therapist that you would hear back from the county, generally within 48 hours. I did not hear back from them. 3 or 4 weeks later, my client's mother told me that she had not heard anything either. So I initiated another contact with San Mateo County and said to them, called up Child Protective Services and said, I have not heard from you. It's been standard protocol for all the years I've practiced, and I practiced in Millbrae from 1979 to 1999, that I would get a call back as part of the investigation to determine the validity of my client's report. And I have not had that return phone call from you. What's going on? And the woman on the end of the phone said that there has been a complete and thorough investigation, and it's closed. And I said to her, I remember like it happened yesterday, because as a therapist, for those folks here who are, calling CPS was something you always remember. And 1987.
Well, we're glad you did, because...
So I said to her, there is no way that a complete and thorough investigation has been done, because no one has ever contacted me from your agency.
Or my client.
And I remember the tone of her voice. It was a stone wall. This has been investigated and closed. I was never contacted by San Mateo Police. The police chief here is quoted in the Chronicle article as saying they went to extraordinary measures. They never took the extraordinary measure of calling me in Millbrae. And I believe personally that a complete and total cover-up was done on Bill Ayres' behalf by the agencies who were put in place to protect all of us.
So if you feel guilty and all these people that do not report well done,
it was before Ayres was arrested, one of Ayres' former partners that her son had been molested, and the former partner, who's a big champion, is like, well, I don't know. She kind of tried to talk her out of it, and she didn't report it, so I reported that woman's name to the California Medical Board.
But I think there's a statute, isn't there, of when you know about it, the mandated reporter isn't a year. You have to report within a year.
I don't know.
But thank God you did report, because there were other victims on file, even though we didn't have the 15-year-old's name, but at least it was there, because I don't think if I called out of the blue like that, they would have. So my hat's off to you for really doing it.
Really.
It's really... because I was told that some doctors just stopped referring kids to him instead of reporting him, and I guess it's a... didn't you not have a psychiatrist who, the psychiatrist told you that there was a psychiatrist who committed suicide, but he told the mother that he was not surprised to hear that Ayres had molested a boy because he heard stories about it, but he didn't feel it was his place to report him. And this is what we heard. Oh, why didn't Dr. Weidelheimer, and then it came out in the paper, another mother about 10 years ago went to the partners and said, my son's getting these physicals, and they had an emergency meeting, and he said, well, I was trained to do this at Judge Baker. There was an excellent academic article that came out of last year, and it talks about the Ayres case, and they questioned, well, none of the partners were trained to do this, so why did they...
It might be interesting that as soon as we filed charges, the entire corporation split.
Dissolved.
Yeah.
Dissolved.
Well, ties in with what you said earlier about being afraid to call the police, afraid to come forward. You're a professional, you're an investigative journalist, and you have this fear. So these doctors, I've dealt with people as well investigating child sexual abuse. There's a tremendous fear of going with these bodies. There's a tremendous fear of even thinking that it might possibly be true. And this is called denial. And that's what we're doing. No, you broke through the denial.
I think I did because I was molested as a kid and I couldn't get any.
Well, I found that the people often the people who investigate and really care about these things are survivors. Not that survivors can't go into denial as well, a survivor who's broken out of denial can change the world.
Yeah. Well, you know, I feel as I was calling for all the victims. I was calling for the Ayres victims. I was calling for myself because when I called the police and my great Watsky family, I had been molested by my older brother, and I don't even remember telling my parents, but apparently I did. Many years later, I talked to my mother about it. I just shut it down. But I feel it must have been so taboo to talk about it in my family. And to break the silence, to call the cops, is breaking my own silence, all the other victims. It's for everybody, and it's really much harder than you think. And I can't even imagine if an Ayres victim tried to call the police, and he wasn't my predator. And I couldn't even imagine. It was so disillusioning to call the medical board. I mean, they are designed, supposedly, to make sure these things.
Do you think when you talk to other survivors, Steve believed he was the only victim. Did you find that with each person?
Absolutely. I found that with every single victim. An interesting sideshow, I started collecting stories on child psychiatrists. I love psychiatrists, but I kept collecting stories and cases, and this ties in with the only victim. I was the search warrant had just happened here in 2006. I was pretty happy about it, and I went up to my old college, and I was staying at their inn in Poughkeepsie, New York, and only as a TV and kind of a study. And a woman came in who was from Illinois, a little bit older than I was, and she'd grown up in Florida, and I started telling her about the Ayres case, and she says, I was molested by a child psychiatrist when I was about 13, and she named the doctor, Dr. Melvin Wise. And I said, you know what? That guy's already been busted, because I had a folder on him. Like, what are the chances of this woman So we ran down the computer and got the LexisNexis system up, and I showed her the stories, and I put her in touch with the original, there were about 20 victims. The guy had died, but he had his license taken away. She thought she was the only victim. And you just saw it in her face, like, oh my God, it just, your whole worldview changes.
Mm-hmm. I don't think a doctor will ever blow the whistle on another doctor, especially when you think of that our own pediatrician, whose own son was molested, he never bothered, to call.
You think that there is an unspoken obligation or commitment to their colleagues?
I think it would be extremely difficult, but I don't think I think the majority of doctors would report. Maybe the facts are different.
But why so many? It was like I described this to somebody in New York. It's like everybody in San Mateo was sleepwalking, and besides, I found that when you start looking for evidence, you take a step towards it. I mean, to make that first step to go to the library is very hard. When I took a step toward it, kind of took a step towards me, and then it seemed like everything was out in the open. I mean, it's just how that doctor who committed suicide, I mean, he suspected it, and I mean, he didn't see it, but he suspected it, so why didn't a couple of them, a couple of people did try to report him 10 years ago, and Children's Services said he's a doctor.
I think not all doctors are as well connected as he was.
Yeah.
So I think he was particularly protected, and there was a lot of effort made to cover up from a number of sources.
So they all did know that.